Documentation and comments are a waste of time. I'll just write my code so well that you just have to read it to understand what it does. So, I'm documenting my code now, and I'm structuring it more diligently. I'm structuring it at all. In a previous devlog, I talked about how I was going to separate the code into layers. Originally, I wasn't planning on making a lot of layers, just two or three, but that turned out to be overly simplistic. In this video, I'm going to explain how I built the layers that make up the game as it is now, and why I think this will help make the rest of the development go smoothly. Smoothlier. In order to enforce the layering, and keep track of what's in each layer, I'm using namespaces. These are like containers for the scripts, and conventionally they match up with the folder structure for the project. In order for a script to interact with a script in a different namespace, you need to add a using statement to the top of the script. This is what helps prevent a circular dependency. If the UI layer has a using statement that lets it access the ships layer, but the ships layer doesn't have a using statement that lets it access the UI layer, then a circular dependency can't happen there. If you try to reference the code in a namespace you aren't using, it will give you an error. So what if you want something that happens in a lower layer, like the ships, to affect something in a higher layer, like the UI, that it knows nothing about? One way? Events. For example, here in the card base layer, the pool fires an event whenever a card is returned to the pool, and the encounter layer subscribes to this event so that whenever it happens, this class in the encounter namespace can do something with the card. In this case, removing any actions that are attached to it. Since once the card goes back to the pool, it should be blanked essentially. And this blanking of the card can't happen in Cardbase itself because Cardbase doesn't know about game actions. So it has to be handled in a higher layer. I talked about this a bit in the spaghetti code video, but that was ages ago. And this is probably stuff you already know if you're a half-decent programmer. But this is the problem with being self-taught. I've got no one to tell me when I'm doing something stupid. I could do anything. I'll put in as many circular dependencies as I want and use global state everywhere. I'll write obscenely long scripts with no separation of concerns. I'll write if statements nested seven levels deep. My methods will be the longest and most poorly named you've ever seen. This is a diagram of how things looked when I started using the namespaces. The arrows indicate a using statement. In this example, Cardbase is the layer that has all the logic for how the cards move between the piles, like the hand and the discard pile and such. Ships has the logic of how the ships work, and Game Actions has the logic for what happens when you play a particular card, like firing a weapon. So the Game Actions namespace knows about the Cardbase and ships layers because it needs to handle the playing of the cards and the implementing of the results of playing them on the ships. But Cardbase and ships don't know about game actions. Also, Cardbase and ships don't know about each other. You get the idea. But as I said, this is how things started. Let's look at how things look now. Oh god. Okay, this may look rather complicated, because it is, but trust me, it's better this way. In the spaghetti code video, I talked about the importance of avoiding circular dependencies at the level of classes, but in practice, within a namespace, I don't think it's a problem. Circular dependencies are pretty much unavoidable, given how closely the classes within a namespace work together. But that's okay, because each namespace is small and focused. That's why there's so many of them. The chaos has been contained in manageable chunks. And that means it's easy enough to understand what a whole namespace is doing. And then when it comes to understanding the larger scale, it's also more understandable because I can see how they interact here on this diagram. For instance, the functionality that existed in the ship's namespace has been split up into ships and space.
Space!
Ships handles the actual calculating of damage to ships, how shields respond and stuff like that. Space is the visual aspect of the ships, how they animate and visually explode and stuff. There does seem to be a bit of an artistry in figuring out how to divide things up in a way that makes sense conceptually and in a way that the code doesn't get overly complicated because of the layering, with the events and such. And deciding which namespaces to put up high and which ones to put low, that can be tricky. In the old diagram, the bridge namespace was at the bottom, and now it's at the top. That took some experimentation to see which way made the interactions more complex. Is it better for the bridge to know about ships, or for ships to know about bridge? I decided that since ships is so fundamental to how the game functions, and bridge is mostly visual responses, I think it makes sense to put bridge higher. Originally, I was maintaining this diagram by simply adding in a new arrow every time I added a using statement that created a new connection. But this became tedious and unreliable, so I wrote a tool to help me. Actually, I just told ChatGPT to write it. It's not very elegant, but it's good enough. The arrows indicate a using statement, and I can right-click to turn off the connections. It is kind of hard to read, but it helps to wiggle the namespace to see how the connecting lines move. I am thinking of reworking the code to make the output more readable, but right now it's good enough. At the moment, I'm just manually recreating it in Lucidchart based on the output here, but it would be nice to generate a more readable diagram automatically. I do wonder if it's worth making it friendly enough to put it on the asset store. It might sell better than my games. There are some tools that do this sort of thing automatically, but most of them are paid as far as I can tell. I got a trial version of JetBrains Rider to try out their type dependency diagram. This is actually pretty useful, but I don't know if I want to get a subscription just for this feature. I have heard good things about Rider though, so maybe it's worth it. Let me know if you've used Rider and if you think it's worth it. I do like that I can also get a view into the dependencies within a namespace. Some of these don't actually look too bad. And I've been properly documenting things now, using a tool called Doxygen. So if you use XML documentation comments, this convention here with the three slashes, it generates documentation automatically based on those comments. For example, if we look at the ship's namespace, we can see the summaries for all of the classes laid out nicely like this. You can select a class and see all the methods and events, along with summaries of them. And you can document the namespaces themselves. I found it really helpful to write out everything important that a namespace is doing, so I know what I'm doing when I'm making new code that interacts with another namespace. It did take a while to write all of this, but I think it was worth it. I found quite a few areas of bad design by going through it systematically, and now I think it's a lot more readable. However, there's one part I still haven't worked on yet. Oh yeah, and I've got more aliens now. I hired a couple more artists and asked them to make aliens using their own art styles. We have this cool robot that uses the Commodore 64 palette, and a Commodore 64, and of course, business jellyfish. And I've started work on the dialogue system, which will be used to interact with the aliens on the view screen. I'm thinking it will have a bit of a Star Control 2 vibe. I'm still not sure how much effect the results of the dialogue interaction should have on the gameplay. Or should it just be for flavour? Should there be a way to talk yourself out of combat? Or into combat? And what should be the rewards of doing so? Is it even that fun to have a way to talk your way out of playing a proper part of the game? This is something I still need to work on. And I do hope to inject some humour and levity into the game this way. Let me know what you think.
What about the UI namespace?
Okay. The UI namespace is huge, and I'm not sure what to do with it yet. Should it be this looming spaghetti monster that hovers over the whole codebase and has using statements dangling into the code below like some eldritch pasta puppeteer? Or should I break it up into lots of different namespaces? I mean, look at this. This is the dependency diagram that Rider generated. This is horrible. I need to break it up. I'm not sure how to do it yet though. I guess different namespaces for different aspects of the UI, but then they'll all need to interact with each other and be managed by a layer above. It's almost a whole other project on top. If anyone out there has any experience with coding challenges like this, I'd love to know what you think. Please help me. I've been using ChatGPT a lot to help refactor and organize this code. It's really useful, but it does have its limitations. It was pretty impressive that I could just paste in loads of code, and it had coherent things to say about it. However, a lot of it does have this wishy-washy tone to it. Seems almost like it's bullshitting me sometimes when it's telling me how to make improvements. Telling me things I want to hear and spouting buzzwords. It is a weird experience to talk to an AI this complex. And maybe the weirdest thing about it is how normal this seems already. You know what it is? These AIs, they are super high int and super low whiz. No real experience or understanding. It's just got so much data on how things usually fit together. And it's amazing how much human intellectual work can be replaced by that process. The thing is, it keeps suggesting more and more abstraction and separations of concerns with, like, observer patterns and event dispatchers. But I really want to move on to making more of the game now. I may come to regret that. But I'm still finding my way through this labyrinth of confusion that is learning game development. I guess we'll see if this is a good level of abstraction, or if I need to do another video like this next year. Or maybe by then we'll have GPT-5 and programmers will be obsolete. But that's a whole other topic. I have actually been wondering if I need to pivot to something else, honestly. Something less replaceable by robots. I mean, I could get back into streaming in a big way and try to... Oh great, look, there's an article about AI Twitch streamers, and that's probably written by an AI. That does it! We need to end capitalism! Just bring on the Star Trek future, please! Oh yeah, and I've started working on the progression system. There's a map now, and you can warp between these sectors. And then if there's an alien ship, you get dialogue, and combat starts. Once you've won, you can get a new card and start building your deck. That's good, isn't it? It's almost starting to look like a game. This part does need a lot of refinement. And that's what I'll be working on next. Probably. We'll see how it goes with the UI refactoring first. Having the documentation of all the other namespaces will definitely help in refactoring the UI code. Now that I can actually see what each namespace and class does at a glance, without having to read through all the connections between classes and trying to keep all that in my head, well, it should make it a lot more doable. Thanks for watching.